Hey, Journey Family Church, thanks for tuning in to another week of Virtual Church. We're so glad you're here to join us again. A couple things before we get started. Number one, we've got multiple Bible studies going on during the week. We've got men's study, women's study, we've got youth group. So if you're interested in joining, we've got it for you. All you have to do is text this number with your name and which one you're interested in, and we'll get you plugged in. Second of all, we've got prayer night on Tuesday nights. It's been so powerful the last couple weeks. And so we want to ask you to join us for that. It's such an awesome night. It's from 7 to 8 on Tuesday nights. I bet you if you show up, you will love it. The next thing is we've got baptism service next Sunday at 4 p.m. at Warner Campground. So we have a little short preview video to show you. So check this out, and I'll explain the details further after.
Still see the steeple, little church on the hill. There's a line at the altar, and every pew had been filled. I remember the water, the choir singing old hymns. Peace in the valley. Oh, as the preacher man he said, in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, the name of the Spirit, you're washed by the blood and buried with Christ, raised in new life, baptized. You hear the sermon, all the people said amen. It was a gift of salvation.
So if you're interested in joining us next Sunday, it's at 4 p.m. at Warner Campground. If you're interested in getting baptized, please call us at the church office at 269-628-2288. We'll make sure you get signed up. It's going to be an awesome service. I cannot wait. It's such an encouraging day. So please join us for that if you feel comfortable. With that, let's get in the message.
Mighty river flowing from your
this time, we'd like to pause and go ahead and go into a time of offering. Again, we say thank you so much for everything that you've given and faithfully given. It's such an encouragement to us, and the Lord's got some mighty plans for it. He's been working, and he's going to continue to work. So with that, let's go ahead and pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for today. I thank you for just another Sunday to be in your house, to just grow with you, Lord, and worship you. Father, we pray for offering right now, Lord, that everything given will be used for you to further your kingdom. We can't wait to see what you're going to do. We know you have great plans. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
wanna go deeper, Lord, with you. I just wanna seek your face. I pray, Lord, increase my faith. I wanna go deeper, Lord. I wanna go deeper, Lord. Been to the mountain, yeah, I know how high life can be. Been through the valley, everywhere in between. I met you, Jesus.
Go deeper, Lord.
just wanna see your face. I pray, Lord, increase my faith. I wanna go deeper, Lord. Wanna go deeper, Lord. I wanna go deeper, Lord. I wanna go deeper, Lord. I wanna go deeper, Lord. We wanna go deeper, Lord. We wanna go.
Good morning. I want to just thank you for joining us here today. It's a pleasure to be able to share with you online, to stay connected with you as we keep going through this time, and hopefully you are being encouraged in the Lord through this. I lead that way to say that we on Tuesday nights are still meeting also for prayer meeting, and our prayer meeting is growing. Our prayer meeting is starting to see people come out and gather, and still stay, you know, safe distances apart, but yet be able to participate in what prayer meeting. Our prayer meeting is set up in a way where we get to sing some worship songs. We have we have some quiet prayer time that leads into the worship, and then sing worship songs, and then. And we break down and we give a prayer emphasis for everybody praying about commonly together. And then we sing another worship song. And then we give a little message of some sort. And then to complete it that night, we finish with a prayer request that is handed out to everybody individually, the things that have been turned into us as a church. So we can cover every prayer request that gets given to us. And then we get to hold them before the Lord and leave on a praise. Well, last 2 weeks now, we have been allowing people the opportunity to give their testimonies. We've used to do that for evening services throughout the year as we gather in people's yards, and that's kind of not, the ability to do that has kind of gone away. So all of a sudden it struck us that God is working in people's lives. Through this process, God has shown himself to people, and testimony things that have just happened of just the greatness of God and what he's done. And how he's seen people through, and how he's been right there. He's been walking with them, strengthening them, healing them, providing for them. We were shocked at the amount of things that God has been doing. The power and the testimonies that were shared, especially this last week. Just amazing. And we don't want you to miss it. We miss out in the way that if the Lord has done something in your life, we want you to be able to participate by giving that to us. If the Lord's been doing something great in your life, and you'd like to let us know what that is by just sending something in to us, whether it be through sending mail to us at P.O. Box 132, Gobles, Michigan, then you do that for us. And we can include that by reading that testimony, encourage people that, hey, even people online are listening and God is working in their life. You need to hear from them. We want to pass that along. If you send a message on our website at journeyfamilychurch.com, contact us and you send a message in there. We'll get that and we'll be able to share that with people and encourage them in the Lord. So I want to encourage you to do that. Let us know how you're doing out there. We don't get to hear all that. We'd love to hear from you, just how you're connecting. So with that, we go into our service today of, it's entitled Little by Little. Because I really believe that God, that's exactly what he's doing. We're hearing people give their testimonies that God is, little by little, he's watering and putting waves of his mercy and grace over us and watering those seeds that have been planted in us, and they're becoming something vibrant and beautiful. Even in this time where we hear so much negative, man, we're hearing just great things of what God is doing. We're just so encouraged. And that's where I need to be. That's where you need to be. I know we need to be encouraged in the Lord. And I'm just so thankful when I say that to know that that we can be born again. What an opportunity to be set free. John 3:3 says it like this. Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." I love this interaction. Jesus was with Nicodemus, and Nicodemus was just really had some pondering questions about how all that worked. It's just so interesting to read that passage in John chapter 3 and just see how the interaction unfolds. But the idea for us of being born again, you know, how could that be? Nicodemus was wondering, and many times we could ask the same question. How can a woman be born again? Well, it's that we can spiritually be born out of what our life has become, and how freeing that is to be born out of the sin that has controlled you for so long, the thing that has kept you bound, the thing that has kept you hiding, the thing that has kept you feeling like you don't measure up in some way, the sin that you just can't break free from. Through the power of Jesus and the Holy Spirit living inside of us, we can be born out of that sin so that we would be brand new in Jesus Christ and set free. And that's exactly the place that people are coming from when they're sharing their testimony with us. The fact that they've been born again. And now that I'm born again, I can see what God is doing. In fact, maybe I've been born again for a long time, but I was falling into this dark place. But yet God has shown me who He is, and He's taking me through. And so it's a beautiful thing to be able to say that, man, I am born again in Jesus Christ. I know that heaven waits for me. 2 Corinthians 3:18. In the second part of this verse says this, because this a lot of this is, ends up being, and this is our walk, is that it's about you and the Lord. We're having this walk with the Lord. He's with you in this life. He's working with you in this life. He isn't leaving you. He's right beside you all the way. He's living inside of you, empowering you by the power of His Spirit. And the second half of 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "And the Lord, who is Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image." An ever-increasing glory is happening. And when you say ever-increasing, that means that as I come to know Him and begin to walk with Him, that little by little, He's showing me who He is. Little by little, He's showing me how to walk. Little by little, He's removing things in my life that maybe I left in there way too long that I thought were okay, but suddenly I realize they're not. Little by little, boy, his righteousness is just consuming me and taking over my life. I can't just stay the same anymore. I start surrendering things in my life that I hadn't surrendered. I start walking in ways that I talk different. I listen to different songs on the radio. I communicate differently with people. My responses are different than they used to be. And I know it's not perfect and you don't have it all nailed down and things still come out the wrong way sometimes. But little by little, God is washing those things out of our life. And that's why I wanted to theme it that way today for us. Because there's a desire that gets into us. Psalm 42:1 says it like this. "As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God." See, anytime I can start talking about nature and being outside, it just speaks to me. As a deer pants for the water, so my soul longs for you. Is your soul really longing for Him? Are you seeking Him out in the morning? Is He the last thought of your day when you lay your head down at night? Are you even throughout the day, say, "Lord, I give you this day. And so as I have given you my day, I'm asking you that you, Lord, allow my spiritual eyes of my life to be open, that I be aware of your presence in my life. So that when I have interactions with people, when I have the opportunity to respond, when I have people who suddenly show up in my life that maybe I haven't seen in a long time, that I would, the first thing on my mind is looking for a way that I could encourage them in the Lord somehow. That I wouldn't be a negative me. That I wouldn't be aggravated at every line I come on that's too long. That I wouldn't be put off by every bit of traffic that is delaying me in some way. But that I'm allowing myself to understand the presence of the Lord is with me, and I will begin to respond and walk this life differently. Psalm 63:1 says it like this: "You, God, are my God." Wow, look, I can just stop right there on that. See, He's a personal Savior. And so are you stopping for a moment to say that you're not serving your parents' God, you're not serving your grandparents' God, you're not serving a youth leader's God or a pastor's God, you're serving your God because you have laid down your life for Him, you've surrendered your life to Him, and you're seeking this life to be with Him. You, God, are my God. Earnestly, I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. Boy, if you can't feel that right now, like we're in a dry and parched land where it feels like there's no water. It feels like, if anything, the water is depleting, if you want to put it that way. There might be water there. There's pockets of water. There's still water holes you can find. But it feels like they're drying up all around us. Are you seeking, earnestly seeking the Lord fervently that he would show you his presence in that. See, Matthew 5, 6 says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled. No matter the fact that the water may be drying up, that it looks like it's going away, that there's only pockets of water, we got to search for it, we got to seek for him earnestly. It says, boy, when you seek for righteousness, you not only will get the water you need, but you will be filled with who he is. You'll be encouraged. You'll be uplifted. You're not controlled by negative circumstances or negative words or negative news reports or negative, negative, negative. No, it's the power of God that is right there for you to strengthen you and take you through and fill you with the goodness of who God is. How does that for encouragement for today? I need some of that encouragement in my life sometimes. I know you do too. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, I understand that many times we don't feel like I don't feel like everything's become new in my life. I feel like, man, I've surrendered my life to the Lord, but boy, it feels anything but new sometimes. There's the old things keep coming up. Yeah, but isn't it funny how suddenly we have an awareness? How all of a sudden our consciences are not seared anymore, but all of a sudden we're softened to things of the Lord. We have this awareness that, man, I'm struggling, Lord. Lord, I didn't respond right again. Lord, I surrender that. Lord, please forgive me for that again. See, he's washing that stuff out of our life, and he loves us so much that he gives us the grace to have that happen. He loves us too much to just leave us there. So we trust him, and we follow him in that way, and we allow that newness to take over our life. And since that newness is there, I want to read a section of Scripture to you that's in 2 Corinthians 3, 12-18. Remember, I've been made new. Since this new way gives us such confidence, we can be very bold. So have you lost your boldness in this time? See, you can tell where the enemy starts to get a hold of us. All of a sudden, we feel quieted. We feel like, I shouldn't speak up. I shouldn't say anything. I can't say anything. What will they say of me? What if I say it wrong? And all these questions. And so we just get reserved. We get quiet. Yet, he says, look, I've been made brand new. I have a testimony of what Jesus did in my life. So I can stand on that. Since this new way gives us such confidence, we can be very bold. We are not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the people of Israel would not see the glory, even though it was destined to fade away. But the people's minds were hardened. And to this day, whenever the old covenant is being read, the same veil covers their minds so that they cannot understand the truth. And this veil can be removed only by believing in Christ. Yes, even today, when they read Moses' writings, their hearts are covered with a veil, and they do not understand. See, when Moses came from being in the presence of the Lord, it was away from the people, and came down off the mountain after being with God, he was shining so brightly that they couldn't even look at him, because just the presence of the Lord was just all over him. And as he was away from the Lord, that slowly faded. But this veil is that veil that he put on so they could even look at him, so they could even see him. Well, see, that same veil that was keeping from seeing the presence of the Lord is what is blinding the eyes. See, we have to pray even more fervently for people that don't understand. I think we need to stop getting angry and stop pointing fingers, and start picking sides, and instead start praying that God would lift the veil from people's hearts around us, that they'd be able to see the glory of God, that they could receive Jesus in their life, because it could only be lifted through Jesus Christ. We have the answer to all humanity, to all glory, to life eternal in heaven. We have the answer in knowing Jesus, because those of us who have accepted him, that veil has been lifted, and it just seems so clear to us, like, how could you not believe this? How could you not follow this? It's so simple. Salvation, the way that it's given, because the veil's been lifted, and that's what we pray for. Like, I don't want to get angry with you. I just want to pray that the veil would be lifted, that you would see Jesus and everything you've wondered about, every question you've ever had. All of a sudden, it begins to be lifted in the light of faith in Jesus and who he is. Not that I don't have questions sometimes, but I know that I can always trust that God knows, even when I don't. And so I just have faith in believing that. Knowing that he has me, knowing that he has the questions, knowing that he has us for all of eternity, that can be lifted. Because look at verse 16. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Do you want to be set free? Do you ever feel like you just are being tied down in some way, like you're being controlled in some way, well, you can be set free in Jesus. So all of us who have had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. You see, I started with that verse earlier, but you see all that was before that right there? It was revealing the Lord Jesus Christ in our life so that we could become more and more, little bit, little by little, getting closer to the glory of the Lord as he pours out His Spirit on us. There's this section of Scripture, as that happens, where the chains, we sing these songs where I feel the chains fall in, I feel the chains fall in. You know, as our life is set free, and we feel victory happen. Because when we come to Jesus, boy, we come, there's a lot of baggage, isn't there? We've come through an awful lot. We've had a lot of history in our lives. None of us want to come in into a church service and have them running a screen of a movie of some sort that would depict your life onto that screen so the whole world could see not all your good moments, but all your bad moments, the darkest moments. So we come with baggage. But Jesus, see, he died for that. And when we surrender our lives to Him, He forgives us of that. And He begins to cut those things out of our life. And I found this passage that I thought was so beautifully written. It's in Deuteronomy 30, verses 6 through 14. It's in the Message Bible. But you need to hear it like this today. So I'm going to give it to you like this. God, your God, will cut away the thick calluses on your heart and your children's hearts, freeing you to love God, your God, with your whole heart, soul, and live, really live. God, your God, will put these curses on your enemies who hated you and were out to get you. Look at the importance of knowing God, your God. And you'll make a new start, listening obediently to God, keeping all His commandments that I'm commanding you today. God, your God, will outdo Himself in making things go well for you. You'll have babies, get calves, grow crops, and enjoy an all-around good life. Yes, God will start enjoying you again, making things go well for you, just as He enjoyed doing it for your ancestors. But only if you listen obediently to God, your God, and keep the commandments and regulations written in the book of Revelation. Nothing half-hearted here. You must return to God, your God, totally, heart and soul, holding nothing back. So where are you with that? This commandment that I'm commanding you today is not too much for you. It's not out of your reach. It's not on a high mountain. You don't have to get mountaineers to climb to a peak and bring it down to your level and explain it before you can live it. And it's not across the ocean. You don't have to send sailors out to get it, bring it back, and explain it before you can live it. No, the word is right here, right now, as near as the tongue in your mouth, as near as the heart in your chest. Just do it. Wow, too bad Nike stole that slogan, right? Telling you just to go out and just do it. Just do it. Well, what about if we just went and just did the Word of God? What if we went out and just lived the Word of God? What if we just really just let Christ just really reign supreme in our lives? What would that look like? It's not too late. See, many times we look at a world going, it's too late, it's out of control. No, what if we really turned back to God and started in a small way, little by little, even in the small towns across America, turning to God with all of our heart? We can point the finger everywhere else, say, what big cities have gone crazy, or we can look at our city and say, let's have revival in our land, and let's start here with us. See, exactly what we've seen happen on prayer nights is as it started small and now is growing and expanding. See, word starts to get out that, man, there's power in what God is doing in people's lives. And we start to gather and we start to come together, and it's powerful to watch that happen as God begins to move in people's lives and we get to hear the victories He's given people. It's so encouraging. So we just go out and just do it. There's a chapter in the book of Mark chapter 5, that I want to share with you today. We're right in the middle of the chaos. Jesus is walking through. Chaos is happening. People are approaching him. I mean, you can't imagine if you're walking with Jesus, he's the Savior of the world, he's the healer, he is the answer to all humanity and mankind for glory, and he's walking the earth. Can you imagine the crowds that are pressing in as the miraculous signs and things that have happened? So what happens is we get this opportunity to take a walk with Jesus in Mark chapter 5, to just see how the little things he was doing to constantly point to who he was and what we have for us. So even so, as we see chaos around us, how can I walk with Jesus in this life? So we'll just unfold it. Start with verse 21. It says, when Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. And one of the synagogue rulers named Jairus came there, seeing Jesus, fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, my little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him. First of all, when we're desperate, do you see? When we're desperate before the Lord, all pride goes away. You have to drop your pride. You have to drop all you know. Everything else that Jairus had already tried was done and over and gone. And all of a sudden, there he was, humbly bowing before Jesus, saying, I need you. As I see this chaos, I see this very beginning is for us. It's time for us to humbly bow before the Savior and say, Lord, I need you. Our situation may not be the same words as Jairus, but we have a desperate need in our life. It's time for us to surrender it and start there, right there on this walk with Jesus. So we go on. A large crowd followed and passed around him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all that she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. And because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I'll be healed. And immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that the power had gone out of him, and he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? The response that comes next would be much like the response that we had. When you start being with Jesus and walking with Jesus, and the pressure of everybody pressing in, just wanting something from Jesus, I would imagine after a little while, you start just getting a little anxious about people, like, just give space. Give me some space. I don't know about you. I'm a person that, when it gets crowded, I just want out. I don't like to be where it's crowded. I like to be on the fringes. If I can go to a restaurant or if I go to a gathering someplace, just be on an edge somewhere. I'd rather be on an edge. I don't really want to be in the middle of it all. I started to have a little bit of anxiety. I could feel it. I try to fight those things off. And maybe you have the same. And I imagine the disciples were having some of that too. Who touched my clothes? Their response was, you see the people crowding against you, his disciples answered, and yet you ask, who touched me? I mean, a little bit, you can almost hear the anxiousness in their voice. Master, you can see the people pressing in, and you're asking a question. For crying out loud, everybody's touching you. Everybody's bumping into you. Everybody, what are you talking about? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. Look at the posture that keeps happening. She knew who Jesus was and she believed. And she said, if I can just reach out. And her faith, and touch of just believing healed her. But then there was a moment of having to face the truth. I think it's so important that we fall at the feet of Jesus and we come honestly and openly with him and we surrender. You speak your mess out. You give that to Jesus. You pray that out to him. All the things that you feel have hurt him, all the things you've hurt somebody else, all the sin that you just can't seem to get over, the thing that just controls you and just burning you down, whatever it is, if it's hurt, anxiety, somebody else is hurt, whatever, pour it out to him in truth. Because he's understanding the touch of belief when you reach out to him. Here's what happened. She was a woman that started at the beginning. there's a woman who was seeking him to touch his cloak. Interesting, when belief touched and changed her, healed her, but the belief was one that struck to her heart. Because of her believing, she reached out. The response from that was healing. The response to Jesus in physically seeing her went from woman to this. Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. See, in receiving Jesus, we become a child of the King. All of a sudden, this was a woman, but in believing, it was daughter. You're freed from your suffering. Go in peace. It's a complete washing of all the struggle, all the anxiety, all the things that doctors couldn't do. It's trusting the Lord wholly. And look what happened, daughter of the King. While he was still speaking, look at this, we go along. You know, for me, a lot of times it's like, when I come across these things, I just want to be, let's one event, the next event, no one gets over, now I get some free time to go do what I want to do, right? I get to relax now. But this is just, as you walk with Jesus, this is just one little section of verses. While he's still speaking, the Bible says, some men came from the house of Jairus. Now, remember back to Jairus, where they're trying to make their way to Jairus' house because he has a child who's passing away, a daughter who's dying. They finally catch up with him on the street because he's not getting there quite fast enough. So Jairus, he was a synagogue ruler. Your daughter is dead, they said. Why bother the teacher anymore? Ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, do not be afraid, just believe. In order for you to follow Jesus, you're going to start blocking some things out. In order for you to follow Jesus, you're going to start shutting some certain newscasts off in your life. In order to start following Jesus wholly, you're going to start listening to him. Let his voice reign supreme in your life. And if you are unable to listen to those, like I am sometimes, unable to listen to some other reports that just hammer away at negativity, I just need to shut them out of my life completely. It's not that I wouldn't be in touch with the world at all, because I would be more in touch than ever, because the closer I get to Jesus, the more opportunity I get to share the great love of Jesus, and all of a sudden I'm more effective for him than I ever was before, whether I know a single newscast is talking about or not. Because Jesus is the answer to all mankind, no matter what situation goes crazy, the answer is Jesus. And so it's so important that I get to know him in that way. So we have to block some things out. Ignore what you're listening to. You're with Jesus right now. Just believe, he said. Verse 37, he did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. See, in reading that, I realized you're not going to be able to always go with the crowd. See, we have the people that we're just so used to following, but even all the people you're with all the time aren't always on the same page with you, are they? They're believing all kinds of things. They got opinions about everything. Everywhere we go, someone's got an opinion, and my opinion is different than their opinion. The way I see it is that, and sharing this report and that report, and this one conflicts with that one, and what's going on, and pretty soon you're so confused, you know what's going on. And so suddenly they say, look, Jairus, your daughter is dead. Tell him not to go in there. And the people are just, oh man, all the opinions start coming in. And right away, Jesus said, you know what? The whole crowd ain't coming there. There's only certain ones that are coming with me. Those who are looking straight forward, knowing that they're with the Savior. And that he said, only believers. I'm only going to follow him. The rest of you, I'm breaking free and I'm going with the direction of what Jesus is saying to do. We will get pulled to the left and to the right and every other which way we start following the path of the world and what they're trying to pull us into and what they're trying to tell us to do next. Stay with Jesus. Sometimes narrow down the group that's who you're running with. God wants to replace that with people who are going to speak godly things into your life instead of all the negativity. So he doesn't let anybody go except the group that I just mentioned. Then verse 38, when they came to the home of the synagogue ruler, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. And he went up to them and said, why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep. But they laughed at him. Now what do you do? Well, people are laughing at me. I guess I should get quieter. I guess when they're laughing at me, I should just go away. They're laughing at me. Maybe I didn't have it right. Maybe I shouldn't trust the Lord like this. Maybe I am foolish for thinking that there is a God and that I believe in Jesus in my life. Just stop all the nonsense. You know what Jesus did? They laughed. The Bible says he put them out. We're going to put some people out of our life. Not only will we follow the crowd, but we will just let some people in your life that are not good for you, it's time for you to put them out of your life. Not that you would never have an opportunity again, but sometimes you need to create separation so that God can speak clearly to you, so you can hear his voice for what he's calling you to do. Because a miracle is waiting next. So verse 38, when they came to the home of the synagogue leader, the ruler, he saw this, the commotion, the wailing, the child is not dead, but he's asleep. They laughed at him. And then right there, after he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and disciples who were with him. They went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and he said to her, Talitha kum, which means, little girl, I say to you, get up. And immediately the girl stood up and walked around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. I just love how, even though with Jesus we see miracle after miracle after miracle, I love how there's constant amazement, how we're constantly astonished at what Jesus is doing, how we are constantly aware of his presence. The Lord has spoken and miracles are taking place. And the same is going on for us today. When we are in that group last night, I mean, I'm just so taken by it. Others who were there were taken by it as well. A lot of times we refer to it as a place where we come in there. These are where the prayer warriors are. These are people who are walking with God. We know that. We see them regularly. And we really get to hear a lot of just little things about what God is doing. So these are very solid people walking with the Lord. But when we open the floor to share some of the struggle and what God has done, it was shocking, some of the things that people have been walking through, some of the things they had to get through with the power of Christ taking them through it, and the things that they've had to face, and the things they've had to say no to, and the things they've had to say yes to, and the things they've had to just trust God for, and the things they didn't understand, but they still went forward in the name of Jesus. It was amazing, just that room, and I started thinking, man, what if the church was gathering together on Sundays? That group, which is much larger, what... I would be just overwhelmed and beyond even speech to understand all that God is doing in people's lives. And so that's why we have to make sure we're taking all those steps in our walk with Jesus to make sure that we are properly doing it, giving him praise, lifting up his name, saying no to some people, saying yes to other people, bowing down and worshiping him, coming real and truthful before him. Man, there's a whole process of things that we need to be doing as we walk with Jesus, as he sets us free and makes us new. And you look at as how did he do that? You look at how people did it. They walked with him. They got right with him. They were truthful with him. They worshiped him. They trusted him. They didn't ignore him. They ignored the others around them. They kept their focus on Jesus. We just have it turned around sometimes, don't we? So it's my encouragement to you today is that we and our small community we'd be the example and turn back to God, that he would not let his wrath fall on us, but that his love and compassion would fall on us as we are able to lead with Jesus in our life. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Oh, how I pray that God would heal our land. Not only our land, but also the landscape of our hearts would be healed for him, that we could be used for him in a much greater way, and be restored and returned to him. And that's my prayer for you today, that we return to Jesus in a great way. Be encouraged that he is with you. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. Turn it all over to him. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity today. I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your power. I thank you for your saving grace. And I pray, God, that you would allow people today to surrender, to bow down before you and say, Lord, I give my life wholly to you. Forgive me of my sin and be my Savior, Lord. That I could even just, if I'm wandering, that I could return, Lord, to you today. Lord, that I could be walking with you every step of the way, Lord. And I would apply these principles in my life of just a walk with you, a daily walk with you. Thank you for your presence and your power. Thank you for what you're about to do, Lord. For you are a great God and greatly to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen.
You're so good.